knew that when I wanted to make changing of the guard, that I would not do it without my own students, my students at St. Barnabas. My heart wouldn't have been in it. And even though I made this film for professional reasons, it really came from the heart. In the film, to a large degree, I'm playing myself. I'm playing an English teacher who feels that he has lived a wasted life and that his work largely was meaningless. And then the students come back and save his life. And I know that it's heresy to say that I could improve on the work of the master, Rod Serling, the greatest television writer in history. But you have to remember that these stories were written on very short notice. Serling may have written a story on a Saturday and they were filming it on Thursday. So any improvements that I could make in the script are with 20/20 hindsight. The original Changing of the Guard, of course, was with all boys, and it was on the heels of World War II. It was made in 1962, so World War II was very much still on people's minds, as September 11th is on our minds today. But the biggest change that I made was that mine is made with all girls. The original one was made with all boys. And although I made this for professional reasons, it was truly a labor of love. The greatest joy that I could ever have in making this film is being reunited with my students from St. Barnabas, the classes of 2008 through 2011, so classes 8 through 11, and that they would come back after all these years and want to be in this film. It says a great deal about them that they would feel such loyalty to me to really put up with an imposition on their lives, an intrusion on their lives, taking up time to memorize lines, taking time to come to the filming, and to really give their best effort. It says a great deal about them. The great love and affection that I have for all of my students, I think, comes through somehow, although I'm not sure how. As a teacher, and as in real life, I was not a touchy-feely person. There are certain teachers, especially some of the younger teachers who were perhaps closer in age to the girls, who had that kind of a personal relationship with them and were involved with them perhaps after school and activities. I ran a very strict classroom, and I did not seat students in a circle. Everybody sat in a row, so it was very similar to my performance in The Changing of the Guard, where the rules were mine, and that's how I ran a classroom. And so, not being a touchy-feely person, and not someone who would really hang out with students, I'm often at a loss as to why I became so close, or why they felt so close to me. I don't really know how that happened. I was telling the girls that you become close with students when you have them in class. Now, bear in mind that I was Dean of Student Affairs and I was in charge of discipline. And most of the girls were not really in any kind of trouble, but you don't really get to know them that well just from being in charge of student affairs. You get to know them as a teacher, as an English teacher. Well, in this episode, to a large degree, I was playing myself, although I'm not that old, and I didn't use my own real name as I did when I made Walking Distance last year. I took the name of Charles Nicholas, which is the first name of my two grandfathers, Charlie and Nick, and I just picked that name so as to not have to use my own name. And I think that in making this episode, I wanted to keep all of the great quality and dialogue of the original episode while making certain changes that I thought would improve the episode. And the first change was the foreshadowing. In the first scene, in the original, you have all of these students who are acting uninterested and bored in the class. And then when the professor reads the poem, the boys continue to look bored and uninterested. Well, I changed that. First off, I changed the poem to Annabel Lee by Poe. And I told the girls for the first part of that scene, I need you to look bored and uninterested. And when they asked, how do we do that, I said, very easy, just act like you always did in my English class. Well, then the real acting came in when they had to act interested. And I think by doing that and by having the pan of the girl suddenly putting everything down and paying attention, that was the foreshadowing that the episode needed. And foreshadowing, if you took my English class, you know what that is. Foreshadowing is always subtle. And of course, the foreshadowing is that more than I ever knew, they were paying attention. And the literature and my teaching did have an impact on them. And the greatest thing, the greatest honor that any teacher can ever have is the continued appreciation and loyalty of his students through the years, especially when you don't expect it. And I never could have imagined the closeness that, I mean, I knew that I felt it for them, I never knew what they felt about me. I hope that they thought I was a good teacher and that they enjoyed the class. But, you know, given my strictness and given the fact that I was not a guidance counselor, I was in charge of discipline, you wouldn't think that. And that's why I use the expression, because I don't know how else to say it. I think the love and affection I had for them came through somehow, and you'll have to ask them how.
I had him 1 year. He was a good teacher. I skipped his class once. and he caught me. He ran downstairs and found me skipping his class. And it was weird because he was our dean too. So I got detention. And that was just awkward because I had to attend his class and sit in detention with him. So he had a sweet side, but he was also tough.
Yeah. I can probably figure that. Yep.
He was a really good teacher. Scary at the same time because he used to put this face and you like never knew like what he was thinking. So you don't know what he was going to say. It's kind of scary.
Yeah.
And like she said, he was our dean, so he can give us detention. So he was a really good teacher, though. One I'll never forget.
Mr. B. Honestly, it was my junior year. And by then, I was so stressed because I was like a horrible student my first year of high school. I failed out of all my honors classes, so I was just trying to get back on the straight and narrow, and I was just freaking out. And English was always kind of my thing. I'm an English major in college and stuff, so English was secondary to me. I never really paid attention. I didn't read any. I mean, I read half of everything, but I never finished it, and I cheated his quizzes. I would ask the people from the periods before what was on them, and then they would tell me. Then I would just look for in the book for the answers, and then I would just wing it in class. But he was my homeroom teacher also. And one day it was raining out, and I was late as per usual because I lived in Pelham Bay, had to drive across town. So I was always like 5 to 10 minutes late, but it was raining and everything was wet, and I was just running into homeroom, and I ate it. And I mean slammed so hard on the floor. I was in hysterics. I was just hysterically laughing, and Mr. B got so worried that I was hurt, but really I was just laughing. And he came over and he like picked me up. Like, I mean, one fell swoop just lifted me, and I was just like, I'm okay, I'm okay. He was like so worried. I felt so bad for laughing because I was like, I thoroughly enjoyed my fall, and he was genuinely worried. So I felt really bad. But that's my Mr. B story, right?
No, he's Mr.
Wow.
B.
He's Mr. B.
He's lucky we don't call him Frank now.
Yeah.
He taught a lot. He didn't give that much work. Well, not that I really did it, but there was work. I may or may not have done it, but he let me slide. So he was a good professor, or teacher, whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, he was a good teacher. Remember some things, not all. I wasn't the brightest in the class. But
you're talking to two of the star students over here.
No. I mean, he had his creepy moments. He was stabbed in the back of the door.
Oh, checking for phones. People. Checking for phones,
yeah.
In the back door. Like, just
in the back of the window. The
phone. That's how you got caught.
It's like that a lot.
He was good. Yeah. One of my faves.
I, on one hand, knew that I would never make this episode unless I was using my St. Barnabas students. And on top of that, I would not make the episode without Natalie and Eleni being my two leads. It had to be those two. And although I never said it to them, I think they knew that without them, I wouldn't have done it. My heart wouldn't have been in it. And they had the most lines. And again, I imposed on, I guess, those two that I'm closest to have to learn these lines. These are girls who have no interest or experience in acting. They were the ones being imposed on. And Natalie and Lainey were very close. They know how much I love them. I love them very much. And if ever I was a mentor to anyone at St. Barnabas, it certainly would have been those two, because we became very close. One of the things that I learned in an all-girls school is that girls need to talk. And I'm generally not good in that role of a guidance counselor. It's like Clint Eastwood said in one of those Dirty Harry movies, man has to know his limitations. But I would always listen to them. And I think that the love and affection I have for them really came through. I'm so proud of Natalie and Lainey and the fine young women that they are, and the students that I remember. And especially poor Natalie had me 3 straight years. Although the third time was her fault. The third time she had a choice, and she chose me for a journalism class. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it, that Natalie took me on purpose.
Me and a few others, but there was 2 others that had him for 3 years. We would try and pry into his personal life every chance we got. So there was always questions before class, after class, during class, just to try to get him off track. And it worked sometimes, not all, but he tried.
I remember the story when he was like, when we first started, he was like, someone in this class reminds me of my ex-girlfriend. I'm not saying who, I'll tell you at the end of the school year. And when we asked him, we were like,
every day.
You haven't told us. And he was like, yeah, it was Tanisha. I was just like, okay. I don't know how to say that one.
He was always joking on me. Yeah, he always made fun of me because I was like, my uniform was always sloppy all the time. So he, when I would see him in the hallways, he'd always make a comment. I'd be like, okay, haha, you're funny. But I think our relationship like grew closer after when he reached out to us for a petition that he was doing, and then this film. So, I mean, it's great. I love keeping in contact with teachers. I still keep in contact with an elementary school teacher too. So, I'd say great.
Cool.
Yeah, I feel like he tried to be serious, but at the same time, too, he wanted you to know, like, that, like, he wanted you to know about him. Like, he used to tell us a lot about him, like, about his personal life and other things that he used to do, like, other teaching stuff. But I feel like he tried to stay serious, but also, like, he was really sweet, and he did reach out to everybody.
Oh, Mr. B, he was always very playful. Like, I had a nose ring today. I didn't wear it because I just avoided the whole thing. But he would be like, take that out. I was like, I can't take it out. It's going to close. And he really didn't care, but he used to just make the point to point it out. He did it today. I didn't have it in. It's just like our thing. He just loves to pick on non-existent problems. But he's great. He was always great.
No, that was my gem. Me busting my booty and him picking me up was just all. I see it to this day, him running with sheer concern and me just being like, oh God, he's thinking this is a lot worse than it is. But no, I don't really, now that I can remember, I blocked a lot of high school memories out of my brain. That's just, they're deep in the subconscious. Freud would be needed to get them out. I just don't know. Yeah, Freud himself would have to raise from the dead and be like, so what do you talk about this? And then,
to a large degree, the teacher in the class, Professor Charles Nicholas, is the teacher that I am in real life. I sit all my students in a row and I pretty much run a tight ship, although I do encourage and want interaction with the students. And to a large degree, this episode was autobiographical. To a large degree, I was playing myself, and I think that as strict as Professor Nicholas was in the episode, you could see how he really feels about his students. I do want to say something about the wonderful actor whose part I played, the English actor Donald Pleasence, who played the original professor in the original The Changing of the Guard, who went by the name of Professor Ellis Fowler. And what's remarkable about the performance of Donald Pleasance is that he was actually younger than I was when I played the part, and he was in his early 40s, and they made him up to be in his mid-70s. He was working at the school in that episode at more than 50 years. In my version, we made it only 40 years. Donald Pleasance is probably best known in America as Dr. Loomis in those Halloween movies, but my favorite role of his was actually he played the murderer in a Columbo episode. And Columbo is just a great, great show. And he played a wine connoisseur, a wine expert, the owner of a winery who murders his brother. And he was just magnificent in that part. And I think that his first role ever in the United States was playing the professor in The Changing of the Guard. It was a magnificent performance. I'm honored to have played the same part as this wonderful actor, Donald Pleasance.
I really had a problem with the person he relieved, really. She had just had it in for me. So no, by the time he was in power, I was like, oh, finally. Someone who will see objectively and be on my side. I mean, not he wasn't, but I never really had a problem where I had to be like, Mr. B, get me out of this. Because he wouldn't have done it, but I was never in that position. So no, I was not in the Mr. B crosshairs and Dean of Discipline.
He let me get away with murder.
No, not me.
Yes. No, I had discipline. I got attention. I went to the office and he called me in and he said, what is it for? I don't even know what it was for. I think I said something back or something like that to a teacher. And then he just said, get out. And he let me leave. And then this other time, we used to get out at like 1:45-ish. But I still had, I had another class after that. That was like a senior thing. And me and my friend got kicked out of class for talking. And we were walking around the halls. And he was like, aren't you supposed to leave? And we were like, yeah. That's how we left.
I was in detention a lot. For late. So I was always late in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Not the most tardy.
Cell phone, being taken away, being late for class, there was definitely a couple of times in detention, we did share that a couple of times.
Yeah, me too. I mentioned earlier him joking on us, on me in the hallways, and I specifically remember one time, it was a dress down, so it's not like you can make fun of me if I'm we had uniform, if I'm dressed down in clothes, but I had like ripped jeans and they were like ripped all over. And he just looks at me and he's just like, could you ever dress properly or normal? I remember looking at him like, come on, man. Like, originality, that's what it is. But that, I guess I never took him serious, even though he has a really scary, serious face. And my year, we always made fun of him for that. And on our prom day, we took a picture of him creeping through the window at our prom because he used to do that as a dean. He'd walk through the hallways and creep, and we'd be in class and just look up and see him looking through our door. So I think he was funny. Everybody laughed at him at some point.
One time I'll never forget, I fell asleep in detention, as if detention wasn't bad enough. As it was, but I was reading a book and I had my head down and then I fell asleep and the book was still up and he came over and I don't remember if he just took the book out of my hand, but he scared the daylights out of me and he never let me live that down for a while.
His group of seniors and like the people, his students that he had for those 3 years that he was there, he was pretty much with all the other kids, but then with us, it was completely different. Yeah. He'll tell you, everybody was equal, but we don't know.
We know. Class of 09 was favorite.
I'm sure there's so many other stories. Everyone has a story, Mr. B1.
Chloe Savage was the only student who was really interested in acting. So when I asked Chloe to be actually my third lead, I knew that she'd be very excited about it. She had made minimally one film at St. Barnabas as a film student, so she had experience in acting. And I gave her actually the longest speech, was the Quality of Mercy speech from The Merchant of Venice.
Quality of mercy is not strength. A drop it as gentle rain from heaven, upon the place beneath.
I know Natalie and Eleni would have killed me if I had given them the quality of mercy speech. But Chloe got through it, and Chloe is someone who has, I think, a dual personality. I mean, Chloe and I were very close, and I had her English for 2 years, and her personality often manifests itself in the acting. I mean, Chloe as the actress isn't necessarily the same Chloe who's more reserved in real life. Chloe, when I had her as a sophomore, had a cyst on her hand, and it was growing and growing, and she had to have this cyst removed, and it was like a big lump on her wrist, and she used to sit there drawing on it. And I said, this kid is very strange. I said, I have to have a talk with this child who's drawing on the cyst. But we've joked about it for years, and I'm very proud of Chloe and that she came through wonderfully in this episode saying the quality of mercy speech. One of the most important additions or changes that I made in my version is the addition of my student Alex Flores. Alexandria Flores was in a horrible automobile accident in May of 2013. And she was in a coma for a month and then never came out of that coma, and then died on June 13th, a month later, of 2013. And I gave the eulogy at her funeral, and I had been in contact with Alex through the years, but I had never actually seen her since she graduated in 2009. Well, I did get together with three of the girls. It was Natalie and Eleni and Alex in February of 2013. And so we had a nice time, and we had photographs together. The only photographs that I have with Alex was from 4 months. Who knew 4 months before she died that we would take these photographs together? And the last thing that I ever said to her was, I love you, and she said, I love you more. And who knew that that would be the last thing she would ever say to me? So I incorporated that into the dialogue.
I love you more.
And it was a tough role to fill, and I had someone in mind to play that role. Damaris Enriquez was my student, class of 2011. Didn't really know Alex, was 2 years younger, so I had someone who had some sort of emotional detachment, which I thought was a good thing, and Damaris was wonderful in the part. As a student, Damaris was a mouse. She was quiet in my class, just did her work, but I had her in mind. She had not heard from me since she graduated in 2011, and I contacted her really out of nowhere. You can just imagine her reaction when I said, how would you like to be in a Twilight Zone episode? That was one thing, but then to tell her she would be the one actress that would be playing a truly deceased student. But it was remarkable, and I think there was a certain amount of pressure on Damaris because Alex's best friends were also part of this production. So I know that Damaris didn't feel any of the pressure because she's not the type. She just did her job. But I know that the other girls were very proud of the job that Damaris did in portraying their great friend, Alex. And I'm certainly very proud of Damaris for the job she did. And I'm telling you right now, Alex has gotten the biggest kick out of this of anyone. She just loves the idea that we made this episode and that she was in it, having an actress portray her in it. We miss her very much, but as much as possible, you don't really die if everybody keeps you alive in their memories.
I'm glad she was in it. I'm happy with what he did because they did have a special relationship. Again, she was a class of 2009. Hello. that's it. She's a part of everybody. Everybody has special memories with her. He had a special relationship with her as well. So I'm glad.
I'm glad he kept it in it.
I actually do not get bored teaching the same stories year after year because each class has its own dynamic. Each set of students, and I've taught all boys, all girls, and co-ed, and middle school, high school, and even college, there's always a unique dynamic. And I don't think there was ever a greater dynamic than at St. Barnabas and this mix of young women that I had. And I think that my enjoyment of literature and grammar is really enhanced by the reaction that I get from the students. I would add that when I would teach a different year, if I moved from a junior to senior year, I would have to teach different things. And at St. Barnabas, I taught different years plus journalism. So it was the same works for a particular year, but it was a great diversity of work. So I never got bored. And I never got bored because I always enjoyed the students. I tell all my students, and I told my students on the first day of class, I always say the same thing on the first day of a new class. And I'm being serious with them. And I said, there are going to be times when you will be bored in my class because not all works of literature are interesting to every student. There are things that I teach that I enjoy more than other things. But what I do expect is to be treated with respect, which means you don't put your head down and go to sleep. Humor me. Pretend you're interested. Stare into space. And I think it would be unfair as a teacher to expect them to always be interested. The answer to the question is, yes, I knew there were times when they were bored, and I didn't mind that. And I think it's my job as a teacher to make it as interesting as possible. For example, some people think vocabulary words are a boring part of English class. Well, as a teacher, I tried to make it more interesting. So we would get a word like glower. A glower is not a word that people generally use in real life, and English teachers tend to know definitions of words more than the average person because we have to teach them and we have to use them. So a word like glower, I would say, which is sort of a mean stare. And I would tell a story of George Foreman. Now, the kids today think of George Foreman as this jolly big guy who does the grill commercials. And that's not the George Foreman that I remember. The George Foreman that I remember as a kid, who was heavyweight champion of the world, was about the meanest guy you'll ever see. And George Foreman said that he would glower at his opponent in the middle of the ring before the opening bell, and it would give him a psychological edge. And if the other fighter ever looked away, Foreman knew that he was going to win that fight in a knockout. Now, when I would tell that story, simply coming from a vocabulary word that I was teaching, that would make the class more interesting. So it was really incumbent upon the teacher, when you have things that would normally not be interesting, to make it more interesting.
No, I think the whole experience was unique. I don't think either of us, I mean, you may have, but I don't think either of us have experienced working with the students and working with people who are not really actors,
right,
and that aren't familiar with the setup or the sound. And it was really refreshing, at least for me, to work with someone or work with a group of people who absorbed it so quickly.
This might be their cue. When you come down to the table, you fold your hands, and your hands are already folded. When you drop your head, you guys drop
you
in unison.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. When he dropped,
you just heard that first bell.
So you're connecting. The energetic connection remains to Frank.
Who were able to take directions. Who listened very well, and in cases where we did have professional actors, how we improvised to handle the situations to get them to come out for what they needed to do.
So you're going to lock that shot once you're in on all them.
For the disappearing act.
Right, so you've got them. You've got to come fall to your knees. You've got to stay right where you are. The ladies then have to get up, get out of the chairs.
Try not moving the chairs.
Wait.
Because, okay. In other words, Winnie's getting the shot of the chairs. I'm getting an establishing shot, so it's going to look uber cool because they're going to disappear.
It was, the first time I've really done a multi-camera shoot where usually it would just be long shots. You know, if I did things like that, it'd be two cameras, really extended shots, and then you cut to the other camera for a different angle for a little while, and you were spending a minute or so on shots. It was a couple of times I've done it over the years with music. I did something with Barry while I shot him recording, but it was, you know, face on for a while, then to the side, and you know, this was just, we had to have the camera set, so because we were only getting one shot at it. that day, and we really didn't know, I guess, what we were walking into in terms of the environment.
Or the hours.
The hours, yeah. We didn't
know. For that particular day.
We didn't know the hours of the day we were getting in there. We didn't know how long it was going to take once we were in. And I think it was the classroom that was the toughest, because the classroom, the lighting, the cameras all react differently to lighting. We really didn't have a chance to get in there and set up and do white balancing and do the light testing that you'd normally do on the course of a day. We were sort of there by the, you know, seat
grace
of our
of
hand,
God,
there by the grace of God, or by the grace of CW
God
Post. God is whoever. Or the grace of Dan Cox, but who's noted in the credits. But I think it was a little bit more of a challenge than we expected.
Yes.
In terms of getting everyone on the mark, getting all the angles so that you could work with the long shots and the close shots. And then the natural, horrible sound of that room. The room was just...
And the variations between the cameras, too.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The feedback.
I found the whole thing just absolutely amazing. Since I was there from the moment you started until, you know, we were finished for the day in the wee hours of the morning. And watching just everything was just... You know, so it's just amazing, because I had the scripts. I was feeding everybody their lines. So, you know, I got to, you know, hear everything over and over and over again, and I'm just amazed, you know, how you guys put it all together. It just blew me away. It's really serious. I saw it up in Newport, you know, 2 weeks ago for the first time, and it did move me to tears. And the whole row, you heard a lot of it. And loved it. And I wasn't familiar with this episode before. I wasn't a big a Rod Serling fan, because I used to get scared as a kid. So I wasn't familiar with this one. But when I caught it, I thought, this looks like it's really good. And then to see how Frank moved his students in there, just, you know, loved it. And as I said, it was very, very touching.
Cool. You have acted in other Dark Shadows productions over the years. So where does changing of the guard rank in the pantheon of your experience in acting?
Number one.
I'm also close with Tanasia. This is all from the class of 2009. And in Tanasia, we kind of gave Tanasia some facial expressions in the first classroom scene. And I said at one point, you know, I make a comment about Tanasia. The line is, close, Miss Gines, closer than usual. And everybody else is laughing. And then at one point, when I make mention of the fact that Tanasia and Megan and Christine are kindred spirits, that they are masters of inexactness, I had Tanasia roll her eyes. And we got that in the film. It was actually very funny. You are masters of inexactness. Simone Gordon was from the graduating class of 2011, which was my last class at St. Barnabas. I had Simone in sophomore year. So when I said goodbye to Simone and Damaris from the class of 2011, I was no longer working at St. Barnabas. I had to go back a week before they graduated just to say goodbye to both of them. Now, in the changing of the guard, in the first scene, I refer to the class as a class of knuckleheads. Now, in real life, and I say this with the greatest love and affection that I could say, the real class of knuckleheads, if I ever had one at St. Barnabas, was the sophomore English class, which I had in the 08-09 school year, but it was the class of 2011. Damaris and Simone were in that class. Now, of course, Damaris and Simone were not knuckleheads. And when I say knuckleheads, I don't mean misbehaving. I mean doing things that students normally do, not pay attention. I feel like I'm talking to myself. I give the same instructions as to what books to bring to tomorrow's class, and my voice carries, and I speak loud. And then with 30 seconds to go, someone in the class would say, what do we have to bring tomorrow? In the class, Damaris was very quiet and just did her work. Simone was, I would say, almost the spokesperson of the class. Whenever I needed to know something in general, Simone would always be the one to answer. I asked, and I don't know how this came up, I asked in the class once, what do girls talk about when they're just amongst themselves and there are no men around? Then I got a variety of answers, and Simone said, I'm going to give you the real answer. What they talk about is each other. And I actually burst out laughing right in the class. She's probably right, but that's the answer that Simone gave. And again, I was only Facebook friends with Simone. I had not been in any contact with her at all. I thought she'd be great in this film, and she met with me and agreed to do it. And I love her dearly. I love the class of 2011 dearly, and I'm happy that I had Damaris and Simone in this episode. It was a joy to see them and a joy to work with them. Megan and Tony were my first graduating class, the class of 2008. And when I got to St. Barnabas, I don't think they knew what to expect. And I was actually not in charge of discipline right away. I was only an English teacher, and I was promoted by the end of that first year. But it was a joy to have Tony and Megan in my very first class, because not only were they fine students, but they made it very pleasurable for me as a teacher. And it was Megan Delvecchio and Tony Marie Galella. And that summer that I started at St. Barnabas, Italy had won the World Cup of Soccer, so we were all very excited about that. It was a true joy having Tony and Megan, and I had not seen them in over 6 years, or in almost 6 years, since graduating in June of 2008, and then I got together with them to talk about this Twilight Zone episode at Dunkin' Donuts in the Bronx in May of 2014, so almost 6 years later, and I repeat that, that I could engender such loyalty from these girls after all these years. It's truly a joy to have them in my life, a joy to have them as part of this episode recorded forever for posterity. Pleasure is all mine to have to be working with my students and have them on film. When I was Dean of Students, I was in charge of discipline. And girls at St. Barnabas had this annoying rule-breaking habit of taking their cell phones out in class. Now, whenever you see a girl staring into her lap, you know she has the cell phone out. Now, the teacher could not see that. But if I was staring in the window in the back of the room, I have taken many a cell phone from students who didn't know I was staring in the back window. Now, I also stared in the front window, which was not to catch people on cell phones. It was to make students and teachers nervous. And I knew they were unnerved by me just having my face against the glass staring at them. I thought it was funny, and I would just keep doing it, and I would notice students keep looking at the window like that, and it would make them very nervous. And sometimes I would make faces, and the students would burst out laughing, and then by the time the teacher would turn around, I would vamoose. And I was just doing it to entertain myself. I mean, sometimes I needed to spice things up, walking the halls, trying to find something to do. And I would add that at the prom in 2009, I think we were at a place called Marina Del Rey. The girls asked me to put my face against the glass at the senior prom that year as a gag, and they actually took a photo of me doing that and posted it on Facebook.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it really was just that idea of the camera being stationary and you're variable is what comes and goes. If you want to have something materialize and dematerialize, you just make sure everything in your environment is exactly the same, and you capture the picture without the thing that's going to appear and disappear, and then you know, between you and Dan getting them to get back into the seats, don't move anything, and don't, you know. And
They were great. They really helped with the continuity. The continuity of the film, or without the continuity of the students who were in the seats, it couldn't have been done.
And I think it was you and Dan who coordinated that whole idea, because we knew we weren't using the audio. We knew we weren't going to be using the audio in the room during that set. We knew there was going to be music over it. It helped a lot, because that allowed you to sort of get the pan, Dan to yell the commands, okay, and heads up, okay, and heads up, and you were kind of, you and Dan just coordinated that beautifully with you doing that sweep around the room while they had just come into view of the camera. And, you know, actually making them appear and disappear is just after the fact. That's all done in post-production, and all just done with very, very simple fade in and fade out in between the two scenes, girls not in chairs, girls in the chairs. But when you do it,
and the
continuity is right, the effect is really cool.
Christine Torres, also from the class of 2009, was someone that I was also very close to. I met with Christine privately and asked her if she wanted to be in this, and she was very excited. And again, Christine was someone I had not seen since she graduated, so I had not seen her in 5 years. And then, in addition to being in it, and in addition to having to learn her lines, she then at the last minute had to learn more lines for the final scene. Christine actually was not originally intended to be in the final scene when I walk away with Christine and Arda, and she learned those lines right on the spot. I was especially grateful to Christine. And Christine is someone who I really remember grew at St. Barnabas. She was quieter as a younger student, and then she became more outgoing, and certainly I don't take any credit for that, but I enjoyed watching her grow. It was a joy to have her in my class. Arda was in my very first class at St. Barnabas. First day, first period in the morning, and it was a class of 11 students, 10 of whom first name ended with an A, and it was Arda and Hannah and Lisa and Melissa and Ariadna and Shayna and Dragana and Christina and Cynthia. I think that's all of them. And Nicolette Francis, of course, always had to be different. Nicolette, whose name I mentioned, she wanted to be in this film and could not be because of her new job, so I promised her that I would mention her. Nicolette was the only one in that class whose first name did not end in an A. But Arda was very interested in being in this film. Arda had been a student of the month at one time. She was just a wonderful student. She was a joy to have in my class. And I got a big kick out of having Arda in the final scene with me. So if you can just picture this dichotomy, I walk into St. Barnabas, my first day on the job at that school, and Arda is in my first class. And 6 years later, Arda and Christine are walking away in the final scene of the changing of the guard. And I thought that was very poignant, and I had always pictured Arda being in that final scene.
In addition to Nicolette Francis, I want to acknowledge two other former students of mine who, like Nicolette, also very much wanted to be in this episode but could not because they were living and working out of town at the time. And I did promise them that I would mention their names in the episode. Kamaya Brown, my brilliant and wonderful student from the class of 2009, and also the equally outstanding Paulniqua Fonken from the class of 2008.
Michelle Rosario is also someone who I had for 3 years in a row. Same deal as Natalie. Michelle had me twice as an English teacher and then chose me as a journalism teacher. And the journalism class took a trip to Tarrytown, New York one time to the Dark Shadows Mansion that was used in the Dark Shadows movies. My students know nothing about Twilight Zone or Dark Shadows but for having me as an English teacher, and they really enjoyed that trip. So Michelle and I are very close.
What was your reaction when you were asked to be in the Twilight Zone episode?
Shit. I was like, damn, I'm going to need a recommendation letter, so I probably should do this. So that was my reaction.
Me, no. I'm not the type to speak in front of people or nothing like that. So, but I said for Mr. B, I'll do it.
Mm. Yeah, he's done a lot for us throughout the years on separate occasions. Recommendation letters, you know, getting us places where he probably shouldn't have been, but getting us out of things. So, you know what? I'll hold it down for Mr. B.
No, I looked it up just to see what my character did to try to act like it, but my three little lines
Not I.
Not I at all. I did not.
I was really excited. I thought it would be something really cool. And then I watched the other film that he did, and I got that made me more excited. Plus working with all the girls I went to school with, so I was really excited to do that.
Me as well, yeah. I was, at first I was kind of like, oh, I don't know, because I'm really nervous all the time, and I know I get stage fright. But when I was like, yeah, why not? And when I did it, it was great. It was good to see everybody, too. It was like our little personal reunion, and it was nice.
It came out really good. I was scared to see what everybody was going to like look like, but I thought it came together really good, and it was a really cute film. I liked it a lot. I think it came out really good.
I don't know. At first, I was a little on the fence. I was like, why? But it's Mr. B, so I never thought twice about it. I was like, yeah, let's do it. It's going to be fun. Get to see people from high school I haven't seen in a while. And it was a good experience. I got to see how filming worked. I liked it. I didn't really, yeah. Not that particular one, the Twilight Zone, yes, because my mother loves the Twilight Zone. And my aunt's father has like the whole box collection. So I'm familiar with the TV series. I just hadn't been familiar with that particular one.
Now, I was especially grateful to Sarah and Cindy for being in this production. I actually did not have them as students. So, I mean, I knew who they were, and I certainly liked them. I thought highly of them in the activities that they were involved in the school. But Sarah was involved in the drama club, and Chloe had told me that Sarah would be very interested. So I was especially grateful, Sarah, for her involvement in this. And I think she did a terrific job, and I was happy to have her in the production insofar as that she did have some acting experience. And the same goes for Cindy, but in Cindy's case, Cindy was a late replacement, and Cindy really came through for me. I was very grateful that Cindy came through, and I even asked Cindy, is it okay if I give you a couple of lines, because she didn't really have time to memorize them, and she did right on the spot. So I think it was a terrific job. I was very happy to have both of them in the episode. They added a great deal to it. Very proud of them. I didn't have them as a teacher, but it was my loss, believe me. They're probably too smart for me anyway. I do have to mention Celeste. Celeste was someone who showed up the day of the shooting, was not intended to be in it, but I needed an extra body. I did not burden her with any lines, but I just said to her, sit there and act bored, and then act like you're paying attention when I'm reading the poem. And so I'm appreciative that sometimes you don't need someone with dialogue, but you do need someone to be an extra, just to be a body. So I was happy to give her proper credit in both the opening and closing credits. Well, my good friends, Helen Samaras and Walter Down, have been my friends for many years from Dark Shadows. We actually have been in skits together. I was in one of Walter's skits. Walter wrote a Dark Shadows parody. It was a comedy. And he asked me to play the part of Sandor, the gypsy. And I played the part of Sandor the same way I played the part of King Johnny Romano when I was in the film The Curse of the Full Moon. And I just used a gypsy accent, which I had gotten from the show. So I have not only good friends with Walter and Helen, but we also worked together on other productions. And they're both very talented. I was very happy to have them in. That Walter was fantastic as the headmaster. Walter is a chef by trade. He's not a teacher. He's not a principal. So really, he really had to act. And of course, Helen, being the housekeeper, and by the way, the name Mrs. Carroll is taken from St. Barnabas, Mrs. Carroll. The lovely Beth Carroll was the person who I actually replaced as the Dean of Student Affairs. Beth Carroll became in charge of development at St. Barnabas, and I took her job, so I thought it was nice to have Helen using the name of Mrs. Carroll. And the only problem was that Helen, as a housekeeper, had to fix herself up to not look so beautiful. But it didn't work. Helen looked just as beautiful as Mrs. Carroll, the housekeeper, as she always does, which is, of course, the most beautiful girl in this entire production. With all due respect to my students, the one beautiful girl in this production, of course, was the lovely Helen Samaras.
That was hysterical. It was a Murphy's Law day, because I really went over to the university because you'd still be waiting for Walter. Poor Walter, love you dearly, Walter, you know that, but he gets lost very, very easily. So I figured that it would be the easiest, because originally I think he was going to be picked up at the train station. So I said, since he knows how to get to my house, pick him up at my house, I'll get him over to the university and we'll take it from there. I didn't know that he had work the next day. So that was a little bit of a problem too. Because I think he got maybe about an hour's sleep that night, if he got that much sleep, because he had to go back to New Jersey. But it was interesting. And now I told you that I choked because I pretty much had my lines down by that morning. But all day long working with everybody, running their lines with them, my brains went to mashed potatoes, and you knew that from 21 takes at my house.
Anything that I would say about the job that Winnie and Tony did on this production could never possibly do it justice, so I think the less I say, the better. I owe them my life, but they may have to settle for $50,000, which I don't have, so they've been settling for all the wine and calorie-ridden pastries that I can buy them. When I was thinking of doing the changing of the guard, I was actually in a conversation with Tony at the Port Washington Library, where he works, and I said, this was probably the right time to do it, but my editor, who for Walking Distance, the Twilight Zone episode that I had made the year before, lived in Pennsylvania, and it was a 90-mile ride, and I had to make the trip four times. Well, now she moved to California. So I said I really didn't have an editor anymore, and that's probably why I wouldn't make it. And Tony said, well, I'm an editor. And I said, I thought you were a sound man. Tony said, no, I do everything. Well, famous last words. I took him up on it. And between Tony and Winnie running the cameras, and Dan, who was credited as the production manager, I wound up having three camera people. It was magnificent. And I think that while Tony was, to a large degree, running the cameras, Winnie was giving her instructions to the girls, things that I don't know anything about, things about staying on your mark, certain angles, and it was crucial, the job that Winnie did, because I would have not known to do that, even if I was not acting. Certainly I was the director in the sense that it was my vision that was being brought to life. But it was Winnie who gave all of the instructions to all of the actors, not just the students. And we really needed it. And the reason that this production is so fabulous is because of the job that Tony and Winnie did. And I'm saying, in addition to all the hours that we put in individually, Tony would work until 9 o'clock on a Tuesday night, 4 weeks in a row. We would then work till 2 in the morning working on this together. And I explained to people that you're talking, for a 30-minute episode, you're talking about really 9 months' worth of work, and I couldn't tell you how many hours were put in. So it was a really collaborative effort, and it was just a wonderful production.
Was it the Beatles that once said we lived it? So it every job brings its own challenges and fun and aggravation and, being able to recreate something that has already been created and given a vision of what Frank had in mind to be able to sort of have come about in itself was fun.
Yeah, just to watch it all unfold. Watch it come together. Yeah, I think that's really it, because you're dealing with something that's so iconic. I mean, you're dealing with the Twilight Zone. And, some of the changes that Frank made, the subtle changes, but also the changes that made it directly personal to him. I mean, as a person who's doing this as a labor of love, you're to make it personal is the only way you're going to be able to put your heart in it and put your soul into it. And I think for us, we sort of appreciated that aspect.
Yes.
Of what Frank was doing. So it made it more, you sort of wanted to see the final end product come out the right way. And it was, the shooting day was long. We didn't expect it to be maybe as long as it was. And it was because you're...
4 in the morning?
But you were working with amateur actors who, But to have got, I mean, if you think about it, to have shot a half an hour episode in one day was kind of cool. I mean, multiple sets and, you know.
Amazing in the fact that we could get it done in one day.
Yeah, yeah. And then really, I mean, the editing part was tough because of the audio challenges, mostly, again, because of you dealing with amateur actors, with all due respect. I mean, the girls were wonderful, but, you know, you're dealing with they're not used to having to project as actors and the room.
And not having the boom and
not having
boom
mics. I mean, there were things where, you know, had we known exactly where we were going to have been, and we could have set up a sound stage and all that. But it was cool because it was sort of done on the run in a way, but yet...
Which just makes it kind of exciting to see the final product.
Yeah.
Because it was done on the run.
Yeah,
so
and then we saw it sort of come together and you went, yeah, so...
There are some things, as you'll see, that never changed from being students at St. Barnabas until now. Close, Miss Gines. Closer than usual. Today she doesn't laugh, everybody else does. You want to start over? Okay.
Keep going so we can get through this once, so you get a feel for it.
All right.
Wait, I have Simone in the shot.
Simone, I think it's gone.
Simone! Get out the way! Rolling.
Hold on.
No, our love. You're right. Okay, don't
That's not as important as where it's
handled. A little relaxed.
I'm just going
to
stand.
A little relaxed. You can smile. This is what you're supposed to do.
What am I doing?
Are you not going to worry?
Move.
Unless you want to be here all night long.
Alright,
Beyond
Black.
Is all this choppiness still going to work okay?
No, if she's reading it, it's not going to be choppy.
She's reading it, won't be choppy. You have time on this card? We don't know.
I don't know.
No idea. Are you focused?
Oh, you guys are in the shot. Shit. Sorry. Start over.
You don't have to look at the camera. Just keep talking. Oh, I'm sorry, Tony.
Wow, we heard him curse after 6 years.
I'm sorry, Tony. Action. One of the problems at St. Barnabas was cell phones. Still a problem.
Rolling.
Wait.
Make sure your phones are off, girls.
Rolling. Everybody's rolling.
Hold
this
button.
Everybody's good?
And?
Transition from the empty chair.
Yeah, but the chairs haven't moved.
That has moved. It's not in the same exact...
Dan's right. Dan's right.
You only had one shot.
If
it's a speed problem...
Nothing like telling me that the first time.
That's what I said.
Yeah? Okay.
Girls, put those phones on my...
I'm looking at the script. I just
like
got
I never left
I'm
high school.
I'm not an actress.
All actors, sometimes. Problems with their lines.
I'm so sorry.
Okay.
Start from
your
speech
portion.
You're doing really good.
Your
voice
sounds perfect.
I got my line.
You're
so cool.
You're way clearer than I was.
You were at my up. Sorry.
Arda, Christina. Cut. I'm so used to saying Christina. Christina. You say action.
We stand for freedom.
Not that.
I have complete confidence in this group of girls.
That's right, professor. You just let me.
I am tired, Karen. I got like 7 lines. You got one. Let's go.
And
I recall that you. I missed the line on.
But we just wanted to let you know that you. Sorry.
What are you making? Pressure!
Sorry.
No pressure.
Stand up, dude.
For the record, my favorite graduating class at St. Barnabas was
2008. We were the best one. We were also the first. Let's slay that down. We were the first. His first junior English class at that school. Other generations are gonna be like, what? That's not true.
2008. Wow. That was his first year. And I attended their graduation, and obviously mine. And his speech for their year was so better. It was nice, because it's his first year, and
I did not lie. I did not lie.
Yeah. I don't know.
2009.
Yes.
09. That's 09. That's not even a question.
That's not a question.
I bet. Fact. Wait, what did Tony and Christine say? Because they're two different classes.
Well, actually, one of them said 2008.
Yeah, that was Tony.
That was Tony.
Yeah, that was Tony. Christine said,
just
"Oh, no,
agreed
with her."
No, and then agreed with her. I said, "Well, maybe, but I don't know."
No,
that
was Christine. No. 2009. It was
the great dispute and the great controversy about me and my years at St. Barnabas is which was my favorite graduating class, and the real controversy, the real dispute, is always between the students in 2008 and 2009. 2008 says they were my favorite because they were my first graduating class, and 2009 was the year that I actually left. And when I gave my speech at the graduation, I was Master of Ceremonies as Dean of Student Affairs, and I told them how proud I was of them and that it was appropriate that I would be leaving St. Barnabas with them. I would say a case can be made for either year, in the sense that there's always a certain affection you have for your first year, first graduating year, 08. But the 09 class, I was with the most years. And I actually had three students who had me 3 years in a row, Natalie, Michelle, and Liz. Imagine being in my class for 3 years. Graduating class of 2010 and 2011, I was also very close to. There's not as much of a controversy because at that time I was fully Dean of Student Affairs and was not teaching many classes. So I wasn't as close with as many students. So in my final year, I only taught one class, which was just 26 students from the class of 2011. So in that sense, individual students, I was not close to as many of them as I was in 08 and 09. However, for the record, and finally, I have no favorite graduating class. I love all my classes and all my students equally.
Thank you, Mr. V,
yeah,
for putting us in this film. It was fun. We hope there are more to come.
Great. Everything she said.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And sorry we were a pain in school.
I apologize for that.